Warning, the full-blown Mind Forge is intended only for mature audiences and may contain adult language, graphic images, and information that could be considered hazardously educational. Viewer discretion is strongly advised.
Hello again, Mind Forgers. I'm your host, Ryan French, and in this episode, we're going to cover some seriously major topics. I'll be bringing you into the instructor's inner circle. Then we're going to learn from our zebra psychotherapist, and finally, we'll shed some light on things that go bump in the night. Fire up those neurons, because you've just entered the full-bore Mind Forge. So what's the instructor's inner circle anyways? Well, only the most revolutionary segment to date. Oh, and before this segment is over, I'm going to tell you the tale of the robotic reloaders. Now, when we enter the instructor's inner circle, we'll be discussing and analyzing some of the many complex facets of our noble passion. I plan on covering a wide range of topics over time, everything from high-stress muscle memory to the psychology of violence education, from shooting competitions to family-oriented gun safety. And for all of you other Mind Forgers out there, you get to hear some pretty cool shop talk from within our mystifying industry. I think it's safe to say that most Mind Forgers have taken at least one formal class of some kind for firearm instruction. For our first dialogue, I wanted to address a few aspects of how we as instructors educate our students. Specifically, I want to talk about the differences between training students in becoming proficient shooters versus competent defenders. So what's the difference anyways? A proficient shooter is effectively someone who is knowledgeable in their firearm's functions and is capable of disassembly, cleaning, loading, and unloading in a safe manner. And a proficient shooter also understands how their sights work and is capable of intentional accuracy on a conventional target. Now, as you probably have experienced yourself, building someone into a proficient shooter is not too terribly difficult. But the two biggest hurdles in doing so tend to revolve around the student's physical capacity to handle the firearm, and then their ability to work through any anxiety they may have throughout the experience. When it comes to shaping a student into a competent defender, it's a completely different set of challenges altogether. This is where I think most firearm instructors experience their greatest personal pressure. The first step to building a defender is to have your student meditate on the understanding that in order to save a life, they must be willing to take a life. I think as instructors, we often take that clarity for granted. It may be old news for us, but we can't presume our students have really accepted what it means to be committed to the potential violence needed for these situations. Communication is key here. Have an open dialogue on this harrowing subject. Once you feel comfortable with your student's acknowledgement of the realities of self-defense, they first need to learn how to become a competent shooter. Without this baseline, how will our students be able to have the confidence needed for advancement? Once this has been established, though, we now have a student who is primed for the challenges that come with learning how to fight with a firearm. This is truly where the rubber meets the road. Most of our students are learning from us because they have a fear or an insecurity about personal protection. Now, these emotions are very healthy, and that's what's kept our ancestors alive. To live every day with a poor consideration of what the world is capable of is just blissful ignorance. Just like traditional martial arts, there are many excellent styles and schools of thought used to educate students on gunfighting. Defensive students need to know a host of vital skills. Most of these teaching systems include muscle memory as a foundation for their drills and exercises. With some intensive diligence, you can harness the power of muscle memory and make unfamiliar actions second nature. Muscle memory is very powerful indeed, and that's why my next point might rock the boat a bit. Muscle memory can be hazardous. For clarity, let me remind us that muscle memory is not actually a process of our muscles remembering anything. Myelination is a correct term for the experience of muscle memory. Essentially, all the nerves in our body can have their signals boosted and strengthened through the frequency of use. It's one of the reasons why you have a left or right hand dominance.
Help!
Yeah.
Oh.
Take my hand.
Ah.
Come on. You're gonna fall unless you take my hand.
No. Give me your other hand.
Oh, my other hand isn't You take my little hand.
No! Get it away from me!
Take it! Take my hand! No!
This boosting effect comes from the sheaths that wrap along the nerve lengths called axons. Maybe you're remembering some of these pictures from episode 1. But here's where I feel muscle memory can become potentially risky. While at the range, if you master a threat ID, draw, fire, and scan sequence, you're obviously tying it to your muscle memory. But did you also know that the neurons in your head are also forming their own sequence that follows your physical action? In 1949, Donald Hebb coined the phrase, neurons that fire together, wire together. When you draw and shoot in a sequence, each individual element of drawing, shooting, sight picture acquisition, etc., eventually blends into one single action that can almost be summoned at will. However, the hazard comes from railroading yourself into a rigid way of reacting. It is critical to train in unfamiliar and unorthodox situations. Let me share a story with you that was told to me years ago when I was working behind the counter in a Florida gun shop. It's called The Tale of the Robotic Reloaders. Back in the 1970s, two New York cops had been partners for about 16 years. They were a solid team and trained together weekly with their Smith & Wesson revolvers. Always challenging one another to increasingly difficult shots at the police range, they always had nearly perfect scores for qualification. They were also knowledgeable enough to reload their own practice ammo. This allowed them to save time and money when they honed their shooting skills. Then, one day they got a call on the radio, and they raced to the scene. Mentally preparing for what was to come, I imagine that they both must have had a strong sense of confidence, knowing full well that they could depend on each other's defensive capabilities and experience. Arriving at the scene of an armed robbery gone wrong, the two veterans assessed the situation and then boldly engaged the assailants. After a few moments, our two veteran police officers were laying side by side. Both had been slain. In the final police report, it was initially overlooked, but later put together. Evidently, they were both found with unloaded revolvers in one hand, while still clutching six empty casings in the other. That spent brass had been meant for the familiar reloading bucket that was always on the floor between them for the last 16 years. Had these two officers trained in the same way they should have been fighting, the outcome of their story might have been very different. Entrenched muscle memory is a double-edged sword. As one becomes better with a given weapon technique, it's critical to never lose the context for the technique's purpose. Each and every time I handle a firearm, I always treat those moments, however brief, as a chance to improve my intentional muscle memory. Whether I'm home doing weapon setup procedures or preparing for a range drill, I don't use administrative reloads down on the table or bench. I capitalize on the chance to do a proper reload up here in my workspace. This principle applies to every manipulation you could have with every piece of gear you could ever use. Conditioning yourself to have decisive control over your muscle memory is just as critical as having a well-trained muscle memory in the first place. This understanding is just as important for your students as it is for your own well-being. To my compatriot instructors, please don't just teach what you know. Lead others by your example. Stress, one of the most influential aspects of our lives. The effects of stress can be life-saving or deadly. Now, I'm not going to start telling you that you should take deep breaths, meditate, or count to 10. Certainly, those are good suggestions when we do get stressed. But you've probably heard all that before. I want to tell you that stress is actually great for you, and you need to learn how to become friends with it. I'm sure that most of you are familiar with the stress hormones that get released during our fight or flight response. Adrenaline, cortisol, and a whole cocktail of glucocorticoids. Mammals all share these hormones for the same reason. They keep us alive during a life or death crisis. Think of a zebra on the savannah. Once there is sight or scent of a lion, these hormones automatically kick in. The heart starts pounding, arteries dilate for extra blood flow to the muscles, even vision sharpens, and the zebra gets ready for action. These same effects happen to us humans when we're confronted with a perceived threat. Just like the zebra, it's all automatic. As a mind forger, understanding stress requires two very different angles of approach. Our first angle comes from a well-known world of fight or flight response. One of the most challenging aspects of defensive training actually comes from trying to create effective stress simulations. The value of intentional stress training comes from the familiarization of its effects on your body. The more familiar you are with stressful simulations, the better your performance will be if you do find yourself fighting for your life. There are many ways to simulate these effects without having to take an adrenaline shot in the arm. The idea is to recreate some of the physical effects these hormones have on us. Now, please understand that these adaptations are dangerous. They are specifically intended to degrade your firearm performance. Even though it should go without saying it, consider it said. You must use extreme caution if you decide to attempt these techniques. I expect all mind forgers to maintain the highest standard of firearm safety at all times. We know that adrenaline causes our hearts to pound, so before a defensive drill, try running in place or doing some push-ups. But make sure you push yourself hard enough to really get your blood moving. If you have an open terrain, try sprinting as fast as you can before engaging your target. Here's a tough one. Number several targets and have someone else create some basic math problems on an index card. Have the shooter solve the problems in order to learn which target is the threat. Want to make it even harder? Require that they sprint up to the index card first. Still not hard enough? Begin an audible countdown once the drill begins. It's been proven that just the knowledge of a time limit causes a stress response in most people. Oh, and make sure you're loud enough too. Try messing with the math they're doing in their heads. Those are just a few simple ways to get creative on the range. There's an infinite number of ways to simulate stress. You can use dummy rounds, alternate your ammo counts, spray bottles, swear words. Just break free of the comfort zone. That's the one place you'll never be if you're fighting for your life. So if taking stress head on is our first approach to stress, what's our second? Well, if you thought those range modifications would be challenging, then you haven't seen anything yet. Our second approach to stress doesn't happen on the range. It happens in your head. Specifically, I want you to try changing your attitude about stress. Now, that's no easy task. Opposite to creating a controlled shooting drill, most of our daily stress exposure is out of our control. We have bills, jobs, traffic, and tons of other things that get the best of us all. Why is that? What is it about daily life that can just drive us crazy sometimes? Is it the lions, tigers, and gun-toting bears? Nope, not even close. If we spoke to a zebra about our human stressors, it would probably laugh right in our face. So I'll let an actual neuroscientist tell you more about it.
You live in a place like this, you're a baboon, and you only have to spend about 3 hours a day getting your calories. And if you only have to work 3 hours a day, you got 9 hours of free time every day to devote to making somebody else just miserable. They're not being stressed by lions chasing them all the time. They're being stressed by each other. They're being stressed by social and psychological tumult invented by their own species. They're a perfect model for westernized stress-related disease.
When you run for your life, basics are all that matter. Lungs work overtime to pump mammoth quantities of oxygen into the bloodstream. The heart races to pump that oxygen throughout the body, so muscles respond instantly.
You need your blood pressure up to deliver that energy. You need to turn off anything that's not essential. Growth, reproduction, you know, you're running for your life. This is no time to ovulate. Tissue repair, all that sort of thing. Do it later if there is a later.
When the zebra escapes, its stress response shuts down. But human beings can't seem to find their off switch.
We turn on the exact same stress response for purely psychological states, thinking about the ozone layer, the taxes coming up, mortality, 30-year mortgages. We turn on the same stress response, and the key difference there is we're not doing it for a real physiological reason, and we're doing it nonstop.
By not turning off the stress response when reacting to life's traffic jams, we wallow in a corrosive bath of hormones. Even though it's not life or death, we hyperventilate, our hearts pound, muscles tense.
Ironically, after a while, the stress response is more damaging than the stressor itself, because the stressor is some psychological nonsense that you're falling for. No zebra on Earth running for its life would understand why fear of speaking in public would cause you to secrete the same hormones that it's doing at that point to save its life.
Additionally, it's been established that where you find yourself in the hierarchies of your life can have a huge impact on your health and stress levels. That might seem obvious at first, but not in the way you might think it is. If you're low on the corporate totem pole, you can spend each day stressing about it, or you can let go of that perception and enjoy being the best three-gun shooter in your weekend training group. It boils down to your perception. I'll never say it's easy, but the truth about daily stress is it's all in our heads. The next time you're feeling that pressure, take stock of what you can and can't control. And if you can't control it, try doing something better with that energy. You know, if push comes to shove, I'm sure there's a zebra out there who just love to hear about your day. Speaking of stress, are you afraid of the dark? Do you even know why? For most of us, the dark is not what we're actually afraid of. It's the potential for what might be lurking within it. Since most attacks and assaults on people happen in low-light circumstances, my suggestion for all mind forgers is to go outside only during the day and only sleep in a well-lit room. That's it. The topic's over. That's it. Okay, so maybe not just yet. But what's the big deal with low-light self-defense? If I can't see them, they can't see me, right? Not exactly. Fine, then I'll just put 1,000 lumen light on my pistol and not worry about it anymore. Well, that's not necessarily going to work either. Low light self-defense isn't a game of hide and go seek. And by turning the lights on, boogeymen don't turn to ash. Lighting has some very surprising effects on human behavior. So before we go any further, let's learn about how we can even see in the first place.
Sight is processed at the back of the brain in the occipital lobes, or visual cortex. Two eyes give a field of vision of about 200 degrees. They can detect 2.3 million different shades of color. And experts estimate they send 72 gigabytes of information to the brain every second.
We like to think of our eyes as state of the art, but 375 million years later, we still can't see things right in front of our noses. Or discern fine details in near darkness the way fish can. It requires a cornea, iris, lens, retina, optic nerves, muscles, let alone the brain's elaborate neural network to interpret images. It's more complicated than any device ever crafted by human intelligence.
So here we are in our modern world, far away from the clutches of natural darkness and the beasts who lurk there. Really, all we've done is trade out who's trying to get at us. Artificial light has become one of the most important aspects of our lives. Think about just how critical modern lighting really is. Not too long ago, there was a suburb in Chicago that went for a long time without any street lamps. It was very dark once the sun set. Eventually, they got their street lamps. Can you guess what happened next? Crime spiked higher than it had ever been before. Criminals could finally see what they were doing. For a moment, think like a street criminal. Why would you ever risk using a flashlight if it meant exposing what you're up to? Law-abiding citizens, however, who carry flashlights, have much more than just an illumination tool with them. The effects of flashlights on a circumstance can be very powerful. Unlike street lamps that are predictable and fixed, personal illumination tools can throw light anywhere. I've been witness to nighttime crowd dispersal in the presence of a powerful pocket light. Light means information, and when someone doesn't want to be made aware of, they tend to keep to the dark. It's very important to keep the context of light in its rightful place. Light equals information, and information is key to conflict avoidance and resolution. Light does more than just supply info, though. When used properly, light can become a weapon. Yes, there are some gnarly combat bezels out there, but that's not what I mean. As weak as our eyes are in the dark, a powerful light can overload our vision instantly. Mobile illumination tools can have anywhere from 50 to 800 lumens. A lumen, by the way, is a unit used to measure how much light is emitted by a source. The higher the lumens, the brighter the light. I've watched belligerent drunks lose their spirit in a split second after being hit with a powerful strobe. That's only possible with lumens typically over 250. One of the most amazing effects of powerful lights and strobes is that they stimulate the optic nerve so much that the brain gets overloaded and forces an involuntary reaction. This is also effective for strangers who might get too close for your comfort. If they have intentions to harm you, they now have to deal with their afflicted vision and the reality that you've acknowledged their presence. That might be enough to get them to move on. Now, if the person is harmless and you illuminate them, they'll just probably think you're rude. But at least you didn't shoot them, right? So what does it mean to bring illumination tools and firearms together? Here's where I see folks lose the context of light all the time. A firearm with a fixed light is now a loaded flashlight. Now, I'm not trying to say that guns and lights are a bad thing. I actually think they should always be together, but not always mounted. It depends on the use. Weapon lights effectively do two things. One, they supply visual information of where a weapon is pointed. And two, they can potentially blind a threat. One of the first things I watch people gravitate towards is big lumens. Well, if big lumens get big effects, why wouldn't we use a 600 lumen weapon light? Why? Because too much light will blind you just the same. Low light training at a shooting range can help prepare you for manipulation and firing. But if you're in your own home, where most weapon lights will be deployed, as prepared as you might be, you can never prepare your optic nerves for the splashback effects of your interior walls. Most ranges don't have white walls next to the targets you might be engaging. Sorry, but your eyes don't care that you're the good guy. Don't believe me? Try this at home. Detach your weapon light and let your eyes get accustomed to the normal darkness in your home. Now shine your light around as you explore your own house. Notice that once you've broken your night vision, if you're not blinded entirely, you can only see well if the weapon light is on. And that makes it a lot harder to regain your night vision. It's like a vicious little cycle. Not the condition I'd want to be in when firing a gun. So what do? My suggestion is keep your weapon light lumens under 100 to 150. That's still quite bright, I promise. Now you also need to consider if your weapon light is throwing a narrow beam of focus light, or is it a diffuse beam? Diffuse beams are great for collecting information because their light is more evenly spread throughout your line of sight. Focus beams are much better at piercing the darkness, but don't always have the same adequate halo effect for your peripheral. Now this entire weapon light concept still begs the question, should a light be attached to the weapon in the first place? That's an excellent question, and it's often debated fiercely. In the end, you'll have to decide what's best for you. But here are a few of my personal approaches. Conceal carry weapons. They don't get a light. I like being able to use a flashlight anytime, anywhere. Being fixed to a weapon makes that prohibitive, obviously. Plus, weapon lights make it that much harder to conceal everything. Vehicle firearms? I say yes, because the vehicle itself is very challenging to maneuver in if you don't have a free hand. Seatbelts, door handles, and even passengers, they may all need your free hand for control. Lastly, home defense firearms. I definitely say yes. The first reason is not unlike the vehicle situation. You're going to need to open doors, dial 911, etc. But the second reason is actually more important. If you're responding to a startling threat perception, you may have just seconds to grab your weapon and fire. But if it's dark and you have loved ones in your home, why would you risk pulling the trigger before your weapon light can confirm who you're shooting? Well, I've heard that in high-stress situations, shooters had a tendency to shoot at light sources. I don't want to get shot because my light is stuck to my gun and now my face is behind my light. Well, I agree with you. And that's all basically true. But the way I see it, in a high-stress situation, I don't want to risk fumbling for a light so I can try to manipulate it awkwardly. I was just woken up. However, if I was a police officer answering a call and, as per the norm, found myself in an unfamiliar place, then I would definitely use a separate light. And I'd shine it from outside my torso at arm's length, kind of like a targeting lure. And if I was a cop, I'd train that way all the time. That way it wouldn't be awkward for me. But when I'm in my own home, I have the advantage. I don't need a light to navigate. And without any doubt, my weapon has tritium night sights. The only information I need now is what made that bump in the night and do I need a bump back? I know we covered quite a bit of information in the episode today. Let's do a quick recap. We learned that muscle memory is a double-edged sword and should only be combined with worthy training. from a qualified source. Then we also saw how critical stress response can be, especially when familiarization has been worked safely into your firearms training. But at least now we have some new perspective on how to keep our daily stress levels to a minimum. And finally, we shed some light on why humans never really got over their fear of the dark, also while uncovering some of the deeper aspects of illumination tool usage. Mind forgers are always challenging themselves to uncover their next limitation, and they should do so before somebody else does. Whether it's psychological, academic, or physical, you deserve to bring your empowerment to its full potential. Until next time.
You can run on for a long time, run on for a long time, run on for a long time. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down. Go tell that long-tongued liar, go and tell that midnight rider, tell the rambler, the gambler, the backbiter, tell him that God's gonna cut him down, tell him that God's gonna cut him down. Well, my goodness gracious, let me tell you the news, my head's been wet with the midnight dew. I've been down on bended knee, talking to the man from Galilee. He spoke to me with a voice so sweet, I thought I heard the shuffle of angels sweep. He called my name and my heart stood still when he said, John, go do my will. Go tell that long-tongued liar, go and tell that midnight rider, tell the rambler, the gambler, the backbiter, tell him that God's gonna cut him down, tell him that God's gonna cut him down. You can run on for a long time, run on for a long time, run on for a long time. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down, sooner or later.